Good morning. So we're putting a new swimming pool in the front there. So do you know how hard it is to get just a half or a quarter load truck of concrete? You know, like, so anyhow, apparently supply chain issues and all this, blah, blah, blah. I don't need to tell you about that. So anyhow, no swimming pool. We had one wedding this week, Patrick King and Rosemary Chiodo. So we keep Patrick and Rosemary in our prayers as they begin their married life together. We had a funeral this week, George Herodine. And so we keep the Herodine family and George in our prayers. And we had one interment, Marion Brick. And so we keep the Brick family and Marion in our prayers. Want to thank you for your contributions to the St. Vincent de Paul collection that was last weekend. I don't have the numbers yet because I didn't get home till late Friday night. But thank you for your contributions to the St. Vincent de Paul. We had a great Life Teen launch on last Sunday, and two of our schools had open houses this week, and a few more have them this coming week. And our Catholic Women's League had a successful meeting. They gave out over 50 service pins, service award pins, including one for somebody who, a woman who had been a member for 70 years, 70 years. So I say that Jerry joined the CWL the day after her first communion. So, today is the 25th Sunday in Ordinary Time. We have Archbishop Leo is our homilist, and Father Savio is our presider. We've got Deacon Dell with us at this Mass. I'm going to invite you to stand and to sing our gathering song, number 564, in your Catholic Book of Worship, 564.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who founded all the commands of your sacred law upon love of you and of our neighbor, grant that by keeping your precepts we may merit to attain eternal life. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked person forsake their way, and the unrighteous person their thoughts. Let that person return to the Lord, that he may have mercy on them, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is near to all who call gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his compassion is over all that he has made. Just in all his ways and kind in all his doings. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth.
The Lord is near to all who call on him.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, Christ will be exalted now as always in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, living is Christ, and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus spoke this parable to his disciples. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing round. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us, who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise be Jesus Christ. My dear brothers and sisters, being fair and just is a virtue that we admire a lot of these days. No one wants to feel as if they have been given the short hand of the stick or have been treated in a manner unworthy of their dignity and worth. And there is much legitimacy to this idea. The notion of fairness is part of our DNA as human beings, and that underscores that we all have certain inalienable rights that need to be respected. But when we apply it to the Lord's own dealings with us and with others, it falls short of a noble and holy consideration, since we would be judging the Lord's actions and attitudes from the perspective of our own categories and standpoint. And we always commit a grave injustice to the Lord Himself when we do this, since, as God Himself tells us to the voice of the prophet Isaiah in today's first reading, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts." In this vein, we can ask ourselves today, do I always think like Christ does? Are my convictions deeply rooted in the words and examples of the Savior of the world? Are my actions imbued with the spirit of the gospel? Do I make myself available to the Lord's inspirations and promptings? How do I put on the mind of Christ every morning and go through my day giving a piece of my heart to those in need, just as Jesus did? Am I on the same wavelength as the Lord and regularly adjust my understanding to His? Lots of questions for sure, but healthy ones, I think, as they help us take a good, honest look at what's brewing in our heart of hearts, since that is from where our actions and life choices flow. The beauty of this much-needed transformation of mind and heart is that when we turn to the Lord in faith and humility and call upon Him as loving children to the loving Father, He will be near to us in His greatness, His mercy, His kindness, His goodness, compassion, and holiness. This is what today's psalm teaches us. We celebrate today, as all Sundays, the Lord's Day, the weekly Easter celebration of the risen Christ, when the family of believers gathers to worship, to intercede, to praise, in unison with Christ, our eternal High Priest. This particular Sunday, however, we also celebrate in a more intentional way, Stewardship Sunday. Reflecting on the Word of God and on the Church's teaching, we acknowledge that we have received so much from the Lord's goodness and have likewise been called to humbly recognize, diligently develop, and generously share all that we are and all that we have for the sake of the kingdom. Today's gospel message speaks to us about God's generosity and our responsibility, indeed crucial and vital aspects of our walk of faith. It is one of these several parables that Jesus used to convey such sublime truths as who God is, who we are, what humanity is all about, our life, and our road to heaven. The parable of the workers in the vineyard, which we heard this Sunday, pointedly holds up a mirror to each of us as disciples of the Master, who has blessed each of us with different and abundant gifts. What are we doing with them? How are we using them generously and responsibly to further spread and strengthen the kingdom of Christ among us? The story Jesus relates is of an employer who hires workmen to harvest grapes, and does so at various times of the day, so that at the end of the day, some have only worked a few hours, while others have worked all day long. There's grumbling when everyone is paid the same average day's wage, regardless of how many hours they worked. To add insult to injury, those who began last got paid first. We can almost hear the cries of, "It's just not fair." But the master paid those who worked all day exactly what he told them they would get. He merely decided to be even more generous and pay everyone, even the latecomers, a full day's wage. To be just is one thing, and an important thing, no doubt. But to be extra generous is even greater from God's point of view. His ways are not our ways. This reminds us of the need to widen our own perspective, to stretch our hearts, to avoid being petty in the ways we think and act, since there is nothing small or petty about God. His thoughts are high above our thoughts. Smallness of heart is not an attractive characteristic trait, nor is it virtuous. God's generosity utterly transcends human generosity, and we're invited to put on a kingdom mindset, since ultimately God, the creator of all, is responsible for all the blessings we possess and enjoy. The incredible gift of life itself was given to us as an undeserved free gift. Furthermore, isn't it true that we all possess a share of unequal natural physical talents and abilities, including different spiritual and intellectual gifts as well? They vary an awful lot from person to person. However, what they all do have in common is that they are distributed to us as free gifts by the Holy Spirit. So, Stewardship Sunday is not just about giving some of our money to the church or to a worthy cause. It's much more than that. It's about sharing our love and kindness, our abilities, our time, our skill sets, our faith, our experiences, our wisdom, a piece of our heart, and then another piece, and another, until we have given it away completely. For it is in giving that we receive, as St. Francis of Assisi taught us. Living out our days, our minutes and hours daily, as givers and not as takers, will fill us with light on the inside, and we will be pleasing to the Lord. St. James tells us that every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights. Let's reflect a little on this. How blessed are we to have been given a new life in baptism. At that most sacred and unforgettable moment in our lives, we were born again and became children of our Heavenly Father, disciples of Jesus Christ, temples of the Holy Spirit, and members of Holy Mother Church. Mother Mary, too, was given to us to be our spiritual mother. Out of the superabundance love for us, we received the gifts of faith, hope, and love, the theological virtues, as powers, capabilities to be united to God. As if that wasn't enough, we were also given the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit to perfect our faith, hope, and love, and which were in turn also strengthened and ignited in us even more so with the sacrament of confirmation. That's just a little glimpse of the kind of supernatural generosity that continuously overflows from God's heart towards each and every one of us through the church's magisterium and ministry. What makes the saints so outstanding is that they are brilliant reflections of God's abundant generosity. But let me take it a step further, if you will. Do we realize that there's a whole other category of spiritual, invisible gifts that were lavishly poured into our lives by God? We call these charisms, and they are intimately linked to the universal call to holiness and service. You see, these different gifts, distributed by the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the risen Lord Jesus, are not so much for our own sanctification as for service to others, to build up the body of Christ, his kingdom on earth. There is no exhaustive list of charisms, even though St. Paul mentions a few in his letters, but they are real and tailor-made for the service we are called to accomplish in Jesus' name. Stewardship, understood in its wider sense, means identifying these charisms, developing them, and sharing them generously with others. They range from the gift of tongues, the prophecy, Christian marriage, the healing and miracles, hospitality and service, discernment and administration, to name a few. Regrettably, some still believe that charisms were just meant for the beginnings of the church, and then God stopped sending them once the church became more established. Nothing could be farther from the truth. In fact, Vatican II's Constitution on the Church, Lumen Gentium, teaches, and I quote, "Allotting his gifts to everyone according as he will, the Holy Spirit distributes special graces among the faithful of every rank. These charismatic gifts, whether they be the most outstanding or the more simple and widely diffused, are to be received with thanksgiving and consolation, for they are exceedingly suitable and useful for the needs of the church." End of quote. The good news is that we are invited and assisted to discern the presence of charisms in our lives, since they are truly powerful, life-giving, and are special abilities given to all the baptized, precisely to empower us so as to be credible witnesses and channels of God's grace for others. These graces, charisms, are given to us to be given away, to be exercised in the service of the Lord and his mystical body, the Church. It is, however, the duty of the ordained members of the body of Christ to coordinate these charisms. In fact, our blessed Lord bestowed onto the apostles and their successors the charism of headship, which is meant to unify, to discern, and to shepherd these particular gifts so that they come to maturity and work together in harmony for God's greater glory and the salvation of souls. It is also true that as human beings, we have all certain natural talents inherited from our parents, but charisms are in a class of their own. We know that our lives as disciples of Jesus Christ are destined to glorify the Lord and to serve our sisters and brothers. We give to the Lord all that we are and all that we have, and we make of our lives a spiritual sacrifice of praise. We intentionally offer to his service our natural abilities and our innate talents, our personalities, our skill sets, our experiences, and all that makes us unique and gifted, all for his greater purpose and greater glory. Charisms come to us as an extra feature of giftedness, God-given empowerments to accomplish a God-given mission. Ministering out of a charism, be it in our parish communities and other modes of communal Christian living, always energizes us, fills us daily with joy, freedom, and meaning. As we discern our own charisms and put them at the service of the wider community, it helps us to understand the charisms and giftedness of others. And this too is wonderful, as it provides an opportunity to nurture their gifts as well. In the end, as the church's role is to evangelize, each of us has their role to play in this great commissioning. Our charisms are meant to likewise empower us to do our part in spreading and proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, in season and out of season. In an average parish setting, stewardship takes the form of identifying the charisms and encouraging their use generously, humbly, creatively, and responsibly. This is much more than cutting a check or making sandwiches. Identifying and soliciting the charisms already present in the lives of our brothers and sisters will allow for greater love to be experienced, since the greatest gift of all is that of the new unifying power of divine love. How wonderfully will all of our communities be transformed and shine forth even more brightly the light of Christ in and through our own lives and the lives of our parishes, if only we tap into these special gifts of the Holy Spirit that He has already given us, and we use them as they were meant to be used. Brothers and sisters, as we celebrate Stewardship Sunday today, let us be mindful of the Lord's many gifts in our lives. Let us be grateful for them and be generous in sharing them with others. Mother Mary is our role model in following Jesus. She was ever open and docile to the Holy Spirit's gifts. She always said yes to His promptings and put into action God's holy will. As Mother of the Church, she continues to pray for us, to carry our prayers to Jesus. Let us turn now our hearts to her, asking for her intercession as we consider how, in our personal lives and communities, we can be responsible, joyful, and fruitful stewards of God's many gifts. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Let us profess the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. In union with Jesus, let us pray to God our Father for all who labor in the vineyard of Christ, the salvation of all people, and those in every danger and need.
For more laborers who will graciously proclaim God's love and work in the Lord's vineyard, and for those who offer their fruitful labor for the benefits of others, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For greater awareness and concern for the vulnerability of migrants and the challenges that they face, and for increased opportunities for their settlement, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all Indigenous children who died well in residential schools, for greater attention to the wounds, the concerns, and pastoral care of the Indigenous peoples within this land, and for recognition of their rich heritage, their culture, and their spirituality, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the Spirit's wisdom and guidance for the Synod of Bishops in Rome next month, and for all Christians who celebrate God's immense love and God's mercy this Sunday, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For an end of violence and a new beginning of peace throughout the world, and for all victims of hurricanes, floods, earthquakes, and violence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who care for the sick, for the physical and spiritual well-being of all parishioners, and for those who are sick, including Laura Guarnacci and all of those on our parish sick list, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for those who have died recently, including George Herodine, Elizabeth Poretta, Marion Brick, Jeanette Poirier, Patrick Meehan, Louise Hazelton, Martha Slatt, Jane Shenney, Eva Munding, and for all of those who are mourning, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of the vineyard, whose ways are not our ways, we pray for the wisdom to understand your graciousness to all people, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may extend your mercy in welcome toward others, even as we hope to receive mercy ourselves. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Receive with favor, O Lord, we pray, the offerings of your people, that what they profess with devotion and faith may be theirs through these heavenly mysteries, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from unending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope and Francis Archbishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. through him and with him and in him. O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us now offer one another a sign of God's peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Graciously raise up, O Lord, those you renew with this sacrament, that we may come to possess your redemption, both in mystery and in the manner of our life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated for some announcements.
So this week, Tuesday morning, we have a Christian meditation, 10:30, and that's online, and the link is on the website. Tuesday evening, we have our confirmation parent and candidate meeting. That's at 7:30. So parents and candidates for confirmation come for the meeting at 7:30 Tuesday evening. Wednesday, we have our lunch with our ministry with maturing adults, lunch from the Mandarin. And you need to get your ticket by Tuesday. The lunch is at 12:30 on Wednesday. Justice Advocacy Group for Homelessness and Hungry is meeting on Wednesday evening after the 7:30 Mass, after the 7 o'clock Mass at 7:30. Our classic movie on Thursday afternoon at 2 o'clock is a comedy, and Thursday evening we have a parents-only meeting for First Communion, so parents-only for First Communion. Parents and candidates for confirmation. So Thursday, parents only, communion, 7:30 meeting. And Friday is the feast of St. Michael the Archangel, and it's also the launch of our EDGE ministry, our youth ministry with grades 5 to 8 in the parish hall at 6 o'clock Friday evening. And you'll see in the pews, the envelopes for the reconciliation, the Truth and Reconciliation collection, which is next Sunday, Saturday and Sunday, reaching out for healing and reconciliation for our Indigenous peoples. We invite couples who celebrate a wedding anniversary in the month of September to stand for a blessing. So, we do have one up there in the loft and down here. So, they are separated only by the gift of music, right?
God our Father, you created man and woman to love each other in the bond of marriage. Bless and strengthen these couples. May their marriage become an increasingly more perfect sign of the unity between Christ and His Church. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. So how many years? 39 years. Congratulations. How many years? 13. Congratulations. How many years? 53. How many years? 57. She did this kind of, oh, they're young uns, 53. How many years? 62. You get to throw your hand. There's hospitality in the parish hall for all these wedding couples. Hospitality in the parish hall. Enjoy some coffee, juice, and donuts.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go in the peace of Christ, glorifying our Lord by the way we live our lives.
Thanks be to God.
Joyful, joyful.